This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Well, we have a show for you I think you're going to thoroughly enjoy. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. Got a couple great guests for you. First up is Jim Rea, who is a modern natural horseman. But we're going to be talking about some of the horse taming techniques of some of the old timers that are no longer with us. Tom Dorrance, when he laid a horse down, what was happening in the horse's brain? Why did he do that? What was the change he was hoping for with the horse? Also, a far less known horseman, but equally impressive and equally creative, Mr. John Sharp, who pioneered the use of a square pin with a bamboo pole for taming wild Mustangs. Jim worked directly with him, has a lot of firsthand accounts and some remarkable stories that I think you might find almost incredible. Jim's a good guy. You're going to enjoy hearing from him. Towards the end of our show, you're going to meet Willow Smart. Got to love that name. That's one of the great all-time names. Willow Smart is the 10th generation of the Parker family, who started the great Parker Ranch on the Big Island of Hawaii. And she is the granddaughter of Richard Smart, who was the last of the Parker family to actually own that ranch. She's going to talk about some of its past and perhaps the future as well, and what she would like to see have happen. Now, speaking of Hawaii, I'll be there hosting the Equine Wellness Symposium, September 11th through 13th. You can get complete details at HawaiiHorseExpo.com. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat 5 times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. New Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you from the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo in Denver, Colorado. This is the Horse Show Live, and I'm your host, Rick Lamb. I have with me Jim Rea. Jim, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you.
First time we've had Jim on the show, but I can already tell you he is a fountain of information. Not only very good horse training advice, he spends a lot of time with my good friend Frank Bell, but he also has some very interesting stories he's going to share with us about some of the legendary horsemen who are no longer with us that helped get this natural horsemanship phenomenon going. First of all, a little bit about you. Tell me about your life.
Well, I was born in Ohio, and I was around horses pretty much all of my life, but I never really had very much interest in them. And I moved to Colorado in 1970, and was in the ski business. And about the mid-80s, I decided that I wanted to be in the dude ranch business, so I thought I ought to find out a little bit more about that. And went down to a seminar with Dick and Ginny Elder in Durango about how to run horses on a dude string, and they start talking about the horses being prey animals and that we're predators, and I thought that was pretty interesting, and that seemed to me like you were going to be able to do things better, faster, and with less blood, and that
So it kind of made sense to you.
That appealed to me. Yes, it did.
And well, early 80s, that was really kind of the early years of this modern revolution in horsemanship.
Yes, it was. And I think that Dick and Ginny Elder were really probably unrecognized, but right out there in the forefront of that. And then a friend of mine that owned a dude ranch in Telluride, by the name of Dave Farney, said, you got to come down here to Norwood because there's this guy from Clements, California, who's really good with horses. You got to see what he's doing. And so I came down to Norwood, and this guy was really good. And that was Pat Pirelli, when Pat was still riding around in a four-horse trailer and doing clinics and demonstrations at county fairs. So
what was the year?
Gosh, that would have been probably about 1990. And then when I got in the dude ranch business, then I used those principles on our horses and did about an hour orientation with people and told them that was the penance that they paid for coming to that ranch. And we had horses that were just as fresh at the end of the season as they were at the beginning. So
did the customers that came there to ride those horses, did they react positively to the input you were giving them?
Yes, very, very much. And we had, you only had to listen to that once. If you were a repeat guest, you didn't have to listen to it again. And I had almost everybody that came back multiple times listen to it again. So that I was either entertaining them or they were forgetting it, one of the two.
Or maybe it was just that good. You know,
well, maybe
that's
it was
another possibility. Okay, so you got a glimpse of Pat Pirelli kind of in the early part of his career. You had some exposure to Tom Dorrance as well.
Well, I did. Not, and unfortunately, it wasn't direct exposure. I didn't have the opportunity to see him, but I know quite a number of people who had been around him. And actually, there's a lady here that you talked to with the Colorado Horse Food Bank who grew up was right next door to Tom.
Yes.
And
I wish I'd known that when I'd interviewed her. I would have talked about that.
Yeah, she was a very interesting lady. And most people who are cognizant of horses know about Tom, but and know that he really got Ray Hunt started, and then Ray Hunt got Buck Brannaman started. And my friend Frank Bell spent a lot of time with Buck. But one of the things that a lot of people don't know is that when Ray Hunt brought Hondo to Tom, and Tom was able to really help Ray turn that horse around, that one of the things that they did was to lay the horse down.
Yeah, and this is something that's hard for a lot of people in this day and age to understand how powerful a strategy that can be, and yet it's not used frivolously. It's reserved for really some pretty seriously disturbed horses.
Well, I think that that's right. And there's a lot of misunderstanding about it, because there are people out there who have laid him down and they just knock him down, just rope their feet and knock him down. I think that the mythology is that it makes the horse submissive and breaks the horse's spirit. And when it's done properly, I don't think that's how it works at all.
How do you think it works then? What do you think psychologically is at the heart of this?
Well, I think psychologically that, first of all, we have to understand that horses defend themselves with their feet. They run and they kick. And when we want to make them submissive, we get control of their feet. Well, if you have, horses are big and strong, and there's nobody that's going to be strong enough to control a horse's feet if it doesn't want to be controlled, if it's really frightened. So what I believe laying a horse down does is it immobilizes their feet. They can't use their feet to run, and so they have to face their fears. And I don't think it's about submission. I think it's about having them face their fears. Frank Bell and I laid a horse down, for example, that had been on a picket line in a hunting camp and was attacked by an elk.
Oh my goodness.
And this horse wouldn't get anywhere near anything that looked like an elk, and horses to him looked a lot like elk. So if you were trying to ride him with other horses, he just wasn't having any of that. I mean, he wouldn't get within 20 feet of another horse. And we laid him down and had, and the way that Frank taught me and Stan Allen taught Frank was that we've got a kind of a special rig that allows you to put a running W on the horse, and you have somebody lead the horse, and then you take the horse's feet away from them pretty slowly. You don't want to knock them down, and they go down on their knees, and then you tie that off on the D-ring on the surcingle that you have, and the horse will usually stay on its knees for a while, and then sooner or later they'll tip over on one side or another, and the upper leg will be sticking straight out because they're frightened. They don't like to. They don't want to lose their mobility and their ability to run. And when that leg relaxes and touches the ground, then you can begin to desensitize the horse. And you can use plastic bags and all kinds of different things. In this horse, the case of this horse that I was talking about, what we did was that we had people start to ride and walk like 25 yards away and then get closer and closer and closer.
While the horse was in this laying down.
While the horse was laid down and was immobilized. And then we had them trot. Start the same place, closer and closer and closer, and then lope. And when they wound up, they were loping 2 feet away from this horse, and worked with the horse. And one of the things that I believe is that, kind of at the end of it for me, I put we make sure that there's a saddle blanket underneath their head so they don't get dirt in their eyes, and I'll put a saddle blanket over the top of their head, and if they'll lay quietly for 5 minutes,
without being able to see,
not being able to see. And still with some stimulation, then they're fine. They're ready.
Yeah.
And you let him back up. And with this horse, then we saddled him and rode him in a formation, stirrup to stirrup.
And didn't have any more problems.
With other horses. Wow. And he was over it.
Yeah.
I've never seen it not benefit a horse.
I'm talking with Jim Rea about laying a horse down. When we get back, round pen, square pen, does it really matter? I think you'll be surprised at the answer. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Welcome back to the Horse Show Live. I'm Rick Lamb. We're at the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo, and I'm talking with natural horseman Jim Rea. We've just been talking about laying a horse down.
In the 1800s, you know, the era of the kind of itinerant horse tamer that went around the country and kind of helped people with their problems, it was a very common technique. It was at the heart of what John Rary did. But it wasn't done frivolously. Like I said, it was for horses that were very disturbed. And I think Ray Hunt also came to look at that as a way to kind of tune up a horse that really wasn't in a crisis mode, but just needed to kind of be reminded a little bit that he can trust the human.
Frank used to train some racehorses and Argentine polo horses, and he had a horse that he probably laid down 20 times. And this horse would come up to Frank at the track before he started and lift its leg up.
He liked it.
I need to get a little calmer here, and I need some help. I had a girl that worked for me at a dude ranch that I ran in Grand County, Colorado, who was a Canadian trick rider. And she laid down every horse she owned because she helped believe that it helped them to become more confident. And I've never seen it harm a horse. I don't think people do it lightly, but if it's done properly, I think most every horse can benefit.
Yeah.
From it.
Well, that's a great great story. I'd known about the connection that Tom and Ray originally met, Elko County Fair, Hondo. Ray had Hondo there and was having trouble with him. Tom helped him, but I didn't know this about the laying him down. So that's a great nugget there. Let's move on to John Sharp, another kind of legendary horse trainer in kind of the wild horse circles. And I first heard about him through Frank Bell years ago. Tell the folks about John Sharp.
John was an absolutely amazing guy, and I met him through Frank at the Wild Horse Workshop at Jefferson County Fairgrounds in 2000. And Frank said, you know, you got to come and see this guy. He does unbelievable things with wild horses. And where most people put him in a round pen and tried to get him to join up, John used a square pen, and he invented this method of gentling wild horses back in the 30s. And John put him in a square pen, and he used a 12-foot bamboo pole. And he would lay the bamboo pole in front of the horse's withers and push down. Well, there's a big gangle of nerves up there. And he would push down on those nerves. Well, horses don't care for that too much. And they get moving around that square pen. And a round pen encourages horses to move. A square pen encourages horses to stop. So those horses will find a corner that they're comfortable in. And by the way, I use this on any kind of horses that are really frightened. I had an Arabian mare that people couldn't touch and couldn't catch and couldn't do this and that with, and she responded really well to this technique. Anyway, you get the horse going around, and it will find a place to stop. And then you take the bamboo pole and you do what John calls fiddling. And you move that bamboo pole back and forth in front of the horse's withers while you're pushing it down. And the ridges on the bamboo pole feel to the horse like another horse grooming them.
Ah.
And it calms them down. And then you take that bamboo pole and you desensitize them all over. I usually start going up and down their neck, scratch them on the pole, and then down the back and scratch them in the croup. with it in the dock of the tail and down their legs. And whenever they get anxious and can't, and you put too much pressure on them, then they start going again. Well, when they start going, you take that pole and go right back to the withers and push down until they're calmed down again, and then start over. And then once you've got them desensitized with that pole, then what you start to do is you go back to the withers, and as you rub on the withers, you start to take a little half step toward the horse.
And oh, you're inside the pen at this
time?
Yeah,
you're inside the pen. I'm sorry, I should have explained that. You're in the middle of the pen. The horse is around the outside of the pen. Well, the horse can't get away from that 12-foot pole because it's a 24-foot pen, and you're in the center.
Right. So no matter where he goes, you can reach him with it.
No matter where he goes, you can reach him.
I had the idea that some part of his method you could do from the outside of the pen, like if the horse was particularly skittish or something.
Well, that kind of comes a little later.
Okay. I'm getting ahead of the story here.
Well, that's all right.
Hold on.
You continue to fiddle, as John calls it, and then you just begin to inch closer and closer to the horse. And you are moving that pole back and forth on the horse's withers, and pretty soon you're up there where your fingers brush against his withers. And then after a while, you replace the pole with your hands, so you scratch the horse on the withers. And then you do what John called rope work. You take a big soft rope and put it over the horse and fish the loop of it underneath with the pole and pick it up, and you begin to work it back and forth in the girth area. Mm-hmm. And then desensitize the horse with the rope. All over its neck and around its back and behind its legs and about every place that you can. And then once the horse is desensitized with the rope, on the back of the pen, usually you make them out of 12-foot panels. So you've got two 12-foot panels together. And on the back of the pen, you have four panels instead of two. And you pull the panels out, so you form a chute. And you put the horse in the chute. And you don't want to squeeze them, but you just get them in there so they can't turn around. And usually we'll put a rope across so they can't back up and go forward. Let them calm down again, maybe give them a little something to eat, and let them get their mouths working. And then you get as many people as you can to put your hands all over the horse from the outside, because you can't be in there with the horse. So you've got people with their hands all over the horse, rubbing their eyes, getting your fingers into their nose if you can, down the legs until they're desensitized to those people. And then you get up, put a halter on the horse, a rope halter on the horse, teach the horse to drop its head. Deb Bennett teaches that when a horse has its head up and its spine in line, that it's in flight mode. And when you bend the neck either vertically or horizontally, changes the electrical impulses to the brain and takes them out of flight mode. And I asked Temple Grandin that question yesterday, and she said, yes, that's what it'll do. So you get the halter on the horse, teach him to drop his head, teach him to yield to pressure, move forward and back.
We are coming to you today, folks, from the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo. My guest is Jim Rea. We're talking about some alternative ways of taming horses. When we get back, stud poker takes on a whole new meaning. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We are back, everybody, at the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo. My guest is Jim Rea. We've been talking about taming methods inspired by the late John Sharp. So you have this horse in the chute. What happens next?
So once you have the horse soft and understanding and yielding to pressure, then you open that chute up. And 90% of the time, the horse simply walks out of the chute. And this can take anywhere from a couple of hours to maybe 4 or 5 or 6 hours. But I can tell you from my own experience, it's way faster.
Where do you think John Sharp got these techniques? Did he just invent them?
Yes. He was the best horseman I have ever personally known, and that's no insult to Frank Bell. I think Frank's really good, but Frank introduced me to John, and I can remember working with John with wild horses, and John would say, well, just change your weight. Step on your right foot a little bit more. And things that were that subtle. Yeah. He was an amazing, amazing horseman. And that's pretty much all he ever did. He drove school buses in Prineville, Oregon, to support himself so that he could do the horses. His granddaughter, Kitty Lauman, finished second in the first Extreme Mustang Makeover, doing mounted shooting from the horse,
and she's using her granddad's technique.
Yeah, using her grandfather's techniques, and she still teaches that. Frank has a video that he did at a couple of the wild horse workshops, and there's some footage of John on there. But he was just an unbelievable horseman. We were in California doing one of these wild horse workshops, and there was a great big aggressive stallion. We all kind of drew straws to see who got to start this horse, and Frank got the short straw, and he got the horse going really, really well. And once we get him out of that chute, then we start to use Frank's seven-step safety mm-hmm. system mm-hmm. on the horse, moving their feet around, and it works really, really well. So about the second day, Frank had a pack saddle on this horse, and there was a woman who had adopted him. And so Frank got the woman and took the horse back into the alley and back of the chutes, walking back and forth. And the woman didn't have any business adopting the horse because she didn't know anything about horses. And this horse just melted down in this alley. And Frank got the lady out of the way and got the horse back into the pen and calmed him down and took the saddle off and kind of got out of his way. And the horse was standing in the middle of the pen. And John was probably in his late 80s at the time and riding around on one of those little red, those little electric scooters.
Right.
And he rode over to this pen and got off that scooter. And, you know, he was a little old bent over man. And he opened the gate and he walked into that pen. And he walked up to this horse who probably weighed 1,250, 1,300 pounds. And he walked up to him and he looked at that horse and he said, "You should be ashamed of yourself. You're better than that. I don't want to ever hear about you doing that again. And I swear to you," that horse dropped its head and licked and chewed, and it made the hair on the back of your neck.
Did you see this?
Stand up. I saw it. I was standing there. Unbelievable. And the other thing that we used to do at those wild horse workshops was to do what they called the stud poker game. And they'd take a card table and put it in the middle of the arena and then let one of the wild horse stallions in there and just and start to play cards. Well, after a little while, that stallion would walk over and start looking over people's shoulders and looking at the cards, kind of like he was giving you a little advice. But that was the great stud poker game.
Well, and the principle there, I would guess, would be that when you are taking all the pressure off of the horse and there's something in front of him that's kind of interesting, that's out of the ordinary for his life experience, and he doesn't feel any pressure from it, his curiosity kind of starts drawing him towards it.
Absolutely, that's what it was. It was all curiosity, and nobody's looking at him. Nobody's putting any pressure on him with their eyes or with anything else. And so they'd just come over and start looking over your shoulder.
Yeah, the great thing about curiosity, and Pat Pirelli kind of drove this point home for me one time, because he told me that the last advice he ever got from Tom Dorrance was to be careful not to knock the curiosity out of young horses. And I talked to him a little bit about the whole notion of curiosity. He said the reason it's so important in horses is because it cannot live in their brain at the same time as fear. So we want them to be curious, because that means they're not afraid at that point. They can start learning.
I think that's exactly right. Another thing that I find with them, and there are a lot of people I think that do this, is breathing into their nose.
Oh.
And because when horses greet each other, they come up with their noses about 2 inches apart, and one horse reaches forward and touches the other horse's nose. And the horse that reaches forward is making a gesture of submission. So when I go out to greet my horses, I put my hand out, which looks like a horse's nose, and wait for them to reach forward and touch my hand, because that starts that relationship off where I would like to have it, where I'm the leader. Then the second thing that horses do is that they put their noses to each other and blow into their horse, into each other's noses. Either they do it softly, or if they do it, if they snort at them, then that's a challenge. So what I do is, the next thing that I do is to breathe into the horse's nose with my nose. And I used to do it with my mouth, because I thought that you couldn't get enough air out of your nose for the horse to pay any attention to it. But then I kind of figured out that when you do it with your mouth, you're giving them the last cup of coffee or the last ham sandwich that you had, and that that might not be too comforting to them. If somebody came up and breathed in my face, I'd want to pretty much know who it was first. But they do respond to your nose, and they can hear and feel that. And I just do it really softly. And I think it works really well. I've had a lot of people say to me, "Well, someday one of those horses is going to bite your face off." But I don't think so. And I asked John about it one time, and John said, well, you know, as a general rule, horses don't bite each other in the face. When they bite, they bite in the neck. If they play a little bit, sometimes they'll faint at each other's cheek. But if they're really going to bite, they bite in the neck or the flank or someplace else. So I think that works really good. And one of the things that I will do with wild horses when I get in there with that horse is to just crouch down and breathe. And they'll hear that. And I've had horses to come up within 6 inches of me that you certainly couldn't touch, but they knew that sound and recognized that sound.
And you're making yourself small. You're certainly not threatening to them. You're a smaller target. I have this theory too, maybe you have some thoughts on it, that sometimes we have to trust the horse not to hurt us in the same way we're asking him to trust us that we won't hurt him. In other words, sometimes we kind of have to, we when we put ourselves in a vulnerable position, there's something passing between us where the horse says, not only do I know you're not going to hurt me now, but I know you're trusting me.
Well, I think that's absolutely true. And that all comes from the energy that's within us and what we do with our brain.
It's kind of like the concept of, you know, it's a little metaphysical, I suppose, but if you're needing love in your life, you give love and you get it back in kind. If you need trust from a horse, you give trust in the hope that you'll get trust back. And of course, you have to balance that with common sense. You don't want to get stomped, but I've seen some incredible things. I saw a trainer in Brazil, we went down there, named Oscar Scarpati Schmidt, that is an incredible horseman from Argentina. And he did the most, I thought at the time, were the most dangerous things I could imagine, putting himself deliberately in harm's way with the horse. And the horse never hurt him, and they bonded so quickly. And his horse he'd never seen before.
The horse knows. I absolutely believe that they read your mind. If you are fearful of them, then you better not put yourself in a position to get hurt, because that horse needs to know that you are the leader.
That's right. My guest has been Jim Rea. Jim, you have a website.
Yes, I do. Gentlehorses.com.
I love it. Well, it's been a real pleasure getting to know you. I don't know why our paths haven't crossed before now.
I don't either.
But we know a lot of the same people, and we really connect. And hopefully we'll stay in touch as time goes on.
I hope so, too.
Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you very much for having me.
You know, in its heyday, it was like no other ranch in the entire world, the Parker Ranch on the Big Island of Hawaii. Well, when we get back, we will get an update from 10th generation Parker family member Willow Smart. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD TV.
RFD TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
or call 615-227-9292.
RFD TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from Equine Affair, Massachusetts, in West Springfield, Massachusetts. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show Live. I have a lady with me who was an absolute surprise to meet her. But I'm so happy I did, because she's going to fill in some pieces of a story that has fascinated me for some time. It's the story of the Parker Ranch. My guest is Willow Smart, the granddaughter of the most recent owner of the ranch, Richard Smart. Willow, welcome to the Horse Show.
Hi, thank you.
I have to tell you, I am a Parker Ranch junkie after having been there and done the research for our TV show, and was fascinated with your grandfather. Tell my audience, who may not be familiar, a little bit about your granddad. He was a very interesting man. An actor, wasn't he? And a Broadway performer. Actor and a singer and so forth?
A performer with also a great deal of care and honor for the land, trying to maintain a stewardship of the ranch. And every time he went away to perform for years, you know, all over the country or even Europe, he always returned to the islands.
His mother, I'm trying to think of what her name was.
Thelma Parker.
Mm-hmm. She received ownership of the ranch when she was a very young girl, correct?
Yes.
And then she sort of had an overseer, or a gentleman that helped her, Alfred Carter, which was a very good time in the history of the ranch. What he did, what he brought it back and made it, took it kind of to its peak, where it had, I think at one time, how many thousands, tens of thousands of cattle?
50,000, 4,000 sheep, 3,000 hogs during World War II.
Hundreds of horses, I know, because they took care of the ranch a horseback. And at one time, I believe that was the largest privately held ranch in the United States.
Yes.
Correct?
That's right.
On the big island of Hawaii. And Grandpa Richard Smart was in a long line of Parkers to own that ranch, but was the final family member to own it, and at his death it passed into a public trust, as I understand it.
Right, uh-huh. He was eighth generation. I would have been 10th.
Yeah, yeah.
So 170 years now.
Now, did you know your grandfather? I can't remember offhand when he passed away.
He passed away in 92, and I wasn't living. My parents were divorced when I was quite young, so he was actually a father figure to me through most of my life.
Did he ever sing for you?
Yes.
You heard him sing?
Yeah. Many, many years ago, I was a young ballet dancer in New York City, and so he would come to visit, and we'd go, you know, do the shows and everything, and I would go see him perform in the islands, and I never performed with him like my cousin did many times, because she's an actress, but...
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, was he kind of torn between his love of the land and the life there on the ranch, which was very different from the footlights and the excitement of Broadway, which is the other part of his life? Was he kind of torn between those two?
Absolutely, and I think that's why he had the best of both worlds, in the sense that he was able to fulfill his dream of performing, but also come back to the land, you know, so.
Yeah. What was, do you know much about
his thinking about the land, his views on stewardship, what he was hoping to accomplish during his time at the helm?
He has always cared for the employees, the families, the Paniolos, the cowboys that worked the ranch on horseback. He was quite devoted to the people of the islands and didn't want it to ever become developed into hotels, strip malls, etc. So he, you know, that was throughout his life. That wasn't something that happened as he became older or mm-hmm. anything like that. So,
well, it was a pretty remarkable thing that he did in preparing for the next phase of Parker Ranch, in that instead of passing it down to family, and I believe he had two sons, is that correct?
Yes.
One of which was your father?
Gil.
Yeah. Instead of doing that, he passed it into kind of a public trust where it would belong to the island and go forward. One of the things we reported, because we that came out in our research, was that neither of his sons were particularly interested in going forward with the ranch. You tell me that's not quite true. What is the reality?
Well, there were times throughout both he had two sons, my father and my uncle, and throughout their lifetimes where they either wanted to continue working on the ranch or did work on the ranch. Both of them did for a number of years. And due to some things with estate taxes or what have you, he was convinced that there was no way to leave a property of this size, generational or not, in this country to his family. And my Uncle Tony and my father Gil had a deep connection to the ranch.
So it was almost like, because of the punitive nature of some taxation in this country, that was a burden that he didn't want to pass on to the next generation.
It had absolutely, just because in the 80s, you know, it was reported that there was no way to leave a ranch of that size to your family because you'd have to sell most of it to pay the debt.
Estate tax, yeah.
To Uncle Sam. I don't believe that that's necessarily so now, but
Is it kind of a matter of sadness that the family lost it, lost the control of the farm, of the ranch?
Absolutely.
Yeah. What would you be doing today if it was still in the family? Any ideas? Would you be over there instead of living in Vermont?
Oh, that's a good question. I think so.
Well, you're here at Equine Affair. You obviously have an interest in horses.
Yes.
What do you do?
I'm in farming now. We make cheese and have a dairy farm in Vermont. So I don't use the horses for working animals or anything. It's just my personal thing. And I think that that's somehow come from the ranch. It's in my blood somehow because yeah. I took many years away from horses and cattle. And then when my father passed away suddenly in 99, I told my husband, we need to get some Herefords. And he said, what? You hate cows. And I thought, well, you know, maybe I don't hate them anymore.
You know, that's interesting you chose Herefords because that was the breed of, mm-hmm. of cattle that sort of revitalized Parker Ranch, mm-hmm. which originally was populated with wild cattle and kind of became a problem. I think it was during Alfred Carter's tenure where he made a point of trying to get the breeding under control, have spaces where they could keep the animals segregated if they needed to, bring in the very high quality bulls, and that was all Hereford cattle at that time.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, when we got our first Herefords on our farm in Vermont, they were the old typey kind, and we raised grass-fed, grass-finished beef for quite some time until we said, you know, we don't have enough land, we're milking both sheep and cows for cheese, and something has to stop here.
Yeah.
I think you can be too diversified. Yeah. Sometimes.
What part of the Parker Ranch history is of greatest interest to you?
I think the Paniolos. We've actually named some cheeses after the Paniolos, oddly enough, and it's kind of a hard story to tell in the Northeast because nobody knows what a Paniolo is or was. I'm really intrigued by how they worked everything, you know, from the top of a horse all day long, and it's a tough life.
It sure is. And a Paniolo is just the origins of the word. Kind of goes back to Espanoles. Mm-hmm. Since the Hawaiians could not, I guess, pronounce the word, the letter S,
mm-hmm.
Espanoles became Paniolos, and mm-hmm. That became synonymous with the vaquero tradition mm-hmm. as it originally started over there. And then it kind of took on its own character.
Yeah.
After that.
Yeah.
And with its own kind of tack and its own rich history and mm-hmm. so forth. Have you ever seen a Paniola saddle?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are unique unto themselves. And because Hawaii is so isolated out there, I think it was more prone to developing in its own isolated way, mm-hmm. and so it wasn't as influenced by other places once they got there.
Yeah, and the land and the heat and the humidity and the salt air certainly ruins a lot, everything, cars, everything, mm-hmm. leather. So they had to just sort of develop based on what they had and what suited them, I guess.
If you had to predict today, say 5 years down the line, what do you think will be happening to Parker Ranch in the future?
That's a good question. I would hope to see diversification and teaching the history, keeping the history alive. There's the Paniola Preservation Society out there that's doing a lot of work to educate and hopefully get some curricula in the schools, because once that history is gone and as there are less and less Paniolos working the ranch, I think there's only 12 or 10 now, and after they pass on, it's not a profession that the young folks want to get into. If the history isn't kept alive, then it's sort of like something that becomes extinct and no one will remember what that was. Yeah. And its importance to the history of Hawaii and the people. And so
I think that in general is an issue. You know, young people have their own interests and they come along, and it takes a certain level of maturity and kind of a special young person, I think, to want to sit down and listen to the elders and listen mm-hmm. to the old stories and try and capture that and carry it forward to the next generation. And I know that from talking with other Hawaiian folks that just about the whole life, the Hawaiian life, which mm-hmm. was a very different kind of a life, you know, several generations ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. Willow, thank you for sharing your story. I mean, I know it's a very personal family story, and I appreciate you looking me up, and I appreciate the kind words about the TV special that we did on the Parker Ranch. And I wish you the very best of luck going forward.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I love your show and listen to your audio online. And
oh, thank you.
I was glad to find you here at the show.
Well, I'm very flattered. Thanks again for being on our show.
Thanks.
And those dates again for the 2015 Equine Wellness Symposium on the Big Island of Hawaii, September 11th through 13th. Details at HawaiiHorseExpo.com. As always, I'll be hosting along with a whole gaggle of veterinarians and university professors talking about equine wellness. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.